I'd also like to thank Brother Jeff Sweeten for directing this lectureship and for including me in this program. I regard it as a great privilege to be included in this lectureship, especially considering how inexperienced I am as a preacher. I just graduated from the Southwest School of Bible Studies this past July. The last speaker that spoke here last night was the director of that school, Brother Joseph Metter, and I'm kind of glad to see he's not out there to credit. It's a hard act to follow, but I'm going to try. Now, some of my former classmates from school have been giving me a hard time. I was just down in Austin last week at the Southwest Lectures, and some of my classmates were picking on me, giving me a hard time about being on the lectureship already. And they're saying, you know, how did somebody as dumb as you, because they knew me for 2 years, they know how dumb I am, how did somebody as dumb as you get put on this lectureship? And all I could do is shrug my shoulders and tell them that Jeff really lives up to his last name, and he's a very charitable man. So anyway, I appreciate it, and I'm thankful for the topic that I've been given, must I obey the civil government? To me, this is a very easy question. Yes, I must, except where the civil government or obedience to the civil government would go against the will of God. So I could sit down now and we'd all be done and we could have a cookie and some coffee, but I guess I better go on a little while longer. So when I was first assigned this topic, I decided that I wanted to approach it from maybe a little different direction than I've seen it covered before. Others have taken this topic and have really gone on and spoken primarily about whether or not a Christian can serve in the military or as a police officer or, you know, a member of the civil government. But instead, I want to focus more on how I, as a Christian, can live in this world under the authority of secular government without being of the world. So my approach to this topic, I first begin with the origin of civil government. By what or by whose authority are civil governments established? And then I want to look at the duties of the civil government. And then, of course, the main question, our submission to the civil government. Must I obey the government? And finally, our obligation to the civil government. What do I or what do we as Christians owe the civil government? So let's look in Romans chapter 13. This will be the main text I look at here. And look at the origin of the civil government. Verses 1 and 2 of Romans 13 inform us that the higher powers, in other words, the civil government, has been ordained or appointed by God. It says, "Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God, the powers that be or are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation." So here we're informed that the higher powers have been ordained or appointed by God. Now in these verses, the word power is translated from the Greek word exousia, which denotes a freedom of action or a right to act. Now these higher powers of government have the freedom and right to act in accordance with the will of God. A word translated as ordained or ordinance is from the Greek word tasso, which means to arrange in an orderly manner, that is, to assign or dispose. This means that God allows a civil government to be set in place to arrange for an orderly society so that men can live in peace. This is why Paul told Timothy to urge his fellow Christians to pray on behalf of the civil government. He said, I exhort therefore... that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 and 2. So the reason civil government is established is so that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in godliness and honesty. Now, Brother Alan Hires said this. He said that civil government is ordained of God for the proper regulation of society. This does not mean that each person in civil government is a child of God, nor does it imply that God is pleased with every decision by governmental rulers. See, the home is a divine arrangement, but not every home is pleasing to God. Nevertheless, The home or family is divinely appointed as the fundamental unit of society. Civil government as an institution therefore exists by the ordination of God. Now, by all this, it is not meant that God establishes the individual governments of men, but that God has made allowances for it to exist. See, man was created in the image of God and was given free will. He was also created with a sense of moral obligation, or a sense of moral oughtness, as some have put it. This is evidenced by the fact that not one culture has ever existed that did not possess some sense of public morality. Brother Roy H. Lanier Sr. said that man has a moral sense that beasts do not have. No heathen tribe has ever been found which did not have a moral standard and which did not deal justice to those who do not conform to that standard. All cultures require adherence to some sort of moral standard of living. Man has always realized the need for order and structure to maintain civilization. Without a moral standard, man is no better than the brute beasts of the field. So in keeping with that moral standard, the only system of government specifically established by God from the beginning was the family unit. God placed the man over the woman and commanded the woman to be in subjection to her husband, Genesis 3 and verse 16. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 3, "But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God." Also, children are in subjection to their parents. Ephesians 6 and verse 1, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Now notice here, their children are told to obey their parents in the Lord. If their parents are telling them or commanding them to do something that would go against God's will or God's law, then of course they are not to obey the parent in that. Of course, the same applies to civil government, as we'll get to in a few minutes. So here in these passages, in 1 Corinthians 11 verse 3 and Ephesians 6 verse 1, we see the proper order of things. God, Christ, husband, wife, and children, each one being in submission to the one above them. In patriarchal times, the religion of man and the government of man were one and the same. The head of the family, the patriarch, was to be the day-to-day leader of the entire extended family. In Abraham's day, the patriarch was given the responsibility of commanding his descendants and his household servants to keep the way of God and to dispense justice where needed. It was said by the Lord of Abraham in Genesis 18, verse 19, he said, "For I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord and do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him." Now in Abraham's family, as well as the families of those patriarchs who remained faithful to God, God's will was their moral code. Now, those people who turned their back on God rejected his moral code as a whole, but they often retained many of the same principles as set forth by God. The code of Hammurabi, I think that's how you say it, but it was written in Mesopotamia several hundred years before the law of Moses was given at Mount Sinai. Yet they both contain a similar standard of morality. Even though the ancient Mesopotamians had long since turned their back on God and fallen into idolatry, they still retained some part of God's morality. So man has created systems of government and organized them to carry out injustice and dispense judgment by combining his God-given sense of moral oughtness with his free will. It is in this sense that God ordained civil government. He allowed it to be established as a reflection of man's morality and free will. So God allowed man to create civil government. He did not establish individual civil governments, just like when the children of Israel wanted to appoint for themselves a king. Through Samuel, told them that it was not a good idea, basically, that this is not a good idea, but since you want to have it so much, I'll let you establish this. But he didn't really desire for them to live under monarchy, but he allowed it to happen. And he set forth duties for which this civil government, this monarchy, was to live by. So in the Bible we read of the duties for which a civil government is ordained or allowed to exist. See, first of all, the government is obligated to uphold principles of righteousness and judgment. Now, I want to illustrate this point by looking at two passages in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 1, and Isaiah 32, verse 1. Chapter 10, verse 1 reads, "Woe unto them that decree unrighteous decrees, and that write grievousness which they have prescribed." And then 32 verse 1 says, "Behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment." We note from these two verses that kings, rulers, or agents of the civil government are commanded to reign in righteousness. Further, rulers are not to make unrighteous decrees. That is, they are not to pass laws or make judgments in which unrighteousness is allowed to continue or to prosper. Also, we see that woe is pronounced on those governments that do not, those rulers or governments that do these things. God condemns those governments that do not uphold His righteousness. The duties of government mentioned in the Bible represent God's ideal plan for them. Now, the first duty of the civil government is to promote good works and condemn evil. Romans 13, verse 3, Paul says, "For rulers are not a terror to the good or to good works, but to the evil." Now, of course, this should be understood as the divine standard for which governments are ordained. Now, William Hendrickson, he's a denominational commentator, but what he had to say here on this verse, he says that Paul refutes the negative attitude towards civil authorities, as if they were always intent upon doing evil. And as if one should be afraid of them, to be sure, the magistrates punish, but under normal circumstances, those who receive punishment have only themselves to blame. Rulers, says Paul, are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. It is clear that in saying this, he is personifying these two kinds of conduct. He means, of course, that rulers are not a terror to those who conduct themselves properly, but to those who conduct themselves badly. It is the latter who have reason to fear. So while the civil government is not a terror to good, it should be a terror to evil. The government's duty should be to suppress evil and to punish it. Now, not every government has operated in this way, of course. The recent government of Saddam Hussein in Iraq or the Taliban in Afghanistan are prime examples of governments that suppressed those who would do good and promoted those whose intent was evil. Also, the same could be said of the German Nazi government in the 40s, or 30s and 40s under Adolf Hitler, or the Russian communists under Joseph Stalin. And in biblical times, of course, the Roman emperors such as Nero and Domitian and others that persecuted Christians and basically had a reign of terror. Now, Romans 13, verse 3 continues. He says, "Wilt thou then be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have the praise of the same." So, Romans 13, verse 4 gives a reason why those who do good need not fear. "For he," or in other words, the ruler or the civil government, "is the minister of God to thee for good." So since it is the civil government's duty to Since it is the civil government's duty to promote good and condemn evil, the best course of action for the Christian is to do good by the government so that they will have nothing to fear. Those who defy the civil government by doing that which is evil have plenty of reasons to fear. Romans 13, verse 4 says, "For he is the minister of God to thee for good, but if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil." So Paul here states another duty of the civil government is to serve as a minister of God to thee in avenging evil. Proverbs 20, verse 2 says, "The fear of a king is as the roaring of a lion. Whoso provoketh him to anger sinneth against his own soul. Now, in Romans 13, verse 4, the Greek word translated as minister comes from the Greek, or comes from the Greek word is diakonos, which means servant. It's from this word that we get the term deacon. Now, a deacon in the church is one who serves the church under the oversight of the eldership. The word deacon can also have a more general meaning or reference to a servant in a more general way. You know, the fact that the ruler or the agent of the civil government is a minister of God means that he is to serve under the oversight of the principles of righteousness. He is to be an executor of God's will and an avenger of God's wrath upon the evil. He beareth not the sword in vain. It's not an empty threat. He will use the sword. He will serve as a revenger of those that would do evil, or revenger upon those who do evil. Now, God has even used even evil rulers in the past to exact his vengeance upon his own people. In Jeremiah 25, verses 7 through 9, the prophet tells the people of Judah that since they had disobeyed God and had turned into idols, that God would send Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, in verse 9, to punish them for their wickedness. So God admits that he is using Nebuchadnezzar, that Nebuchadnezzar is his servant. Then in Isaiah 8, verse 7, we read how God allowed Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, to conquer the northern kingdom in order to punish them for their idolatrous ways. Chapter 10, verses 12 through 15, show how God would punish the king of Assyria for his temerity or his boldness in saying, by the strength of my hand I have done it, and by my wisdom, in verse 13. He gave the credit to himself. He did not give the credit to God. Further, the prophet Isaiah said of this impudence, said, shall the axe boast itself against him that heweth therewith? Shall the axe boast against the guy that's using the axe to chop wood? That's what he's... with this here, the prophet Isaiah sets forth the principle that rulers are tools of God. They are used by him in order to exact vengeance upon the evildoer. And when that tool or that government goes beyond that which is authorized by God, they fall under the condemnation of God. Also, Proverbs 16, verse 12 says in regards to God's condemnation upon unrighteous rulers, he says, it is an abomination to kings to commit wickedness, for the throne is established by righteousness. God considers those rulers or governments that go beyond what God authorizes and which use their office to commit or sanction wickedness to be an abomination. And God upholds those governments that act righteously towards men. He establishes them because of their righteousness. The king that faithfully judges the poor, his throne shall be established forever. Proverbs 29 and verse 14. So the civil government, its origin comes from God, and God has given duties to the civil government that the civil government must perform. And if the government is to perform its duties, then all men must be in submission to the civil government. Civil governments are established under the allowance of God for the purpose of maintaining order and upholding righteousness. Therefore, in the interest of righteousness, all men, especially Christians, must submit or be subject to the civil government. The New Testament sets this principle forth quite clearly. Romans 13, verse 1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. Romans 13, verse 5, wherefore you must needs be subject. Also, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme, or unto governors as unto them that are sent by them for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. Also in Titus chapter 2, verse 1, Paul said for Titus to speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. And in Titus 3, 1, one of these things that became sound doctrine was to put them in, was to, for him to tell the Christians and to put them in mind to be subject to the principalities and powers, to obey magistrates, to be ready to every good work. Now the command here to submit or be subject is from, they both come from the Greek word hupotasso, which means to be appointed to be under. Now conversely, one can infer that civil government is appointed to be over or ordained to be over men. Paul in Romans 13 verse 1 uses the present passive imperative form of hupotasso, which the importance of this command is stressed by the use of the imperative. The present tense also implies that it is a command to be heeded both in the here and now and in the future as well. So Paul says, in effect, let every soul be subject continually, or be continually in subjection unto the higher powers. Now, to many early Christians, this submission to Roman rule must have been a very hard thing to understand and to put into practice. Brother Burton Kaufman points out some very important considerations as to why this section of Scripture so desperately needed inclusion. First, he says, Christians were widely regarded as a Jewish sect, were known to acknowledge, supreme allegiance to the Messiah, and were easily confused with the extreme nationalistic movement among the Jews. Also, number two, certain Christian practices might have led them easily to despise the state. For instance, in all legal and civil disputes, Christians were encouraged to bypass the pagan courts of justice in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Also, Christians did not participate in the public festivals and ceremonies given over to emperor worship. And third, even beyond all this, was the very evil nature of the Roman government itself. To the Christian, Rome must have certainly appeared to be the seat of Satan himself, with the Colosseum and all the bloodshed that was taking place there, all the moral debauchery that was taking place. It must have seemed just like the seat of Satan himself. Also, just as the Jewish Christians may have struggled with the idea of submitting to the civil government, so must have the Gentile Christians as well. Brother R.L. Whiteside said they might feel that having confessed Jesus Christ as their king, they were not subject to any other government. Hence the special need for Paul's plain and emphatic teaching. To make such submission to earthly governments seem more reasonable and necessary, he informs them that all power is of God, and that civil governments are ordained of God. He who denies this fact denies the voice of inspiration. Now, Romans 13, verse 1, Paul emphasizes the need for the Christian to be subject to the civil government, as it is an ordained institution of God. Furthermore, in Romans 13, verse 2, he says, whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. So seemingly an answer to the general attitude of the Jews and Christians towards Roman rule, Paul tells those who would consider participation in some form of civil disobedience or rebellion that such resistance to the God-authorized civil government would in fact be resistance against God himself. So Paul teaches here in Romans 13 verse 2 that the result of resisting God by resisting the civil government will be judgment or damnation. Now, Peter also stressed the need for Christians to be in subjection to the civil government. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 through 17, he says, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors, as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free and not using your liberty as a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. So every child of God must willingly submit himself to the civil government, and we must do so for the Lord's sake. Do we love the Lord? Do we truly love the Lord? Then we will do the things that he asks of us, and for his sake. Because it is his will for all men, even if the civil government itself does not engender loyalty. As in the case of Roman rule in Palestine, where there was often great oppression of the Hebrews. Christians may have held great antipathy toward the Roman government, but they were commanded to live as peaceable citizens despite their distaste for many of the things that Roman law sanctioned. And likewise with us today, we must live in peace in our government. We may not like some of the things that our government is doing this day and age, but we must still submit to them in areas where we can without violating God's will. Now, the motivation that Peter gives is that in their civil obedience, they may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. See, these foolish, ignorant men claim that Christians, in recognizing no power higher than Christ and his word, were in fact rebellious against Rome. But Paul stated that the main reason for Christian to be in subjection to the civil government is that the civil rule is ordained by God. In addition to this, Paul gives two other motivations for such submission. These are both found in Romans chapter 13, verses 4 and 5. Verse 4, he says, "For he is a minister of God to thee for good." In verse 5, "Wherefore you must needs be subject not only for wrath, but also for conscience' sake." So the first motivation he gives for subjecting oneself to the civil government is to avoid the wrath of the government. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Paul says that in order to avoid the wrath of the government, one must obey the laws and regulations imposed by it. Now, the second motivation for the Christian's obedience to the civil government is for the sake of his conscience. Now, Brother Whiteside said, "A man who can disobey the laws of his government without having any remorse of conscience is lacking in respect for God's commands. Every citizen is expected to be in subjection to the laws of the country. From the humblest citizen to the chief executive, all are subject to the laws of the government." So we must submit to the civil government in areas where we can, but in areas where the civil government goes against God's will, then of course we are to obey God rather than men. This is the one exception. Remember that Peter and John, preaching in the temple in Acts chapter 4 and chapter 5, they went into the temple, they preached on Jesus, they were arrested, they were brought before the chief priests and scribes and commanded not to preach anymore in the name of Christ. Of course, they said that we can't do except what we've been told by, I'm paraphrasing, of course, then, of course, they go back into the temple and they're preaching again. And once again, they're brought out and told that they are not to preach any more on Jesus. And Peter answers and said that we are to obey God rather than men in Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Remember Daniel and his three companions in Babylon in the book of Daniel. How Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow down to this idol or this golden image. They stood up to the civil government. Daniel, when they were commanded not to pray to anyone except to King Darius, he prayed to God, and anyway, he still obeyed God rather than men. They understood this principle, and I think we probably understand this as well. Now, in keeping with this one exception, the Christian must also realize that just because the government allows something does not mean that that God allows it as well. For example, the United States government recognizes many reasons and causes for divorce, ranging from abandonment to the no-fault divorce and these other things. And in every case, our government allows both parties to remarry. Now, in contrast, though, God only authorizes divorce for the reason of fornication and only allows the innocent spouse to remarry. Now, there are many other examples in our society, in our country, where the laws of our land have loosed, where God still binds. We must always remember that we must obey God rather than men, in areas where obedience to man's law requires or allows us to be disobedient to God. So we must submit to the civil government in areas where we can, without it conflicting God's will. Also, with this, we see our obligation to the civil government. Now, just as Peter and Paul urged Christians to submit themselves to the tyrannical rule of Rome, all men everywhere have the responsibility to submit to whatever system of civil government that is in authority. Seems like people in this country seem to have this idea that democracy is the divine will of God and that it is our duty as the United States to ensure that the entire world lives under a system of democracy. Now, of course, we don't read this in the Bible. Our country and democracies, I think, were established and are maybe the best system of government for the gospel to thrive in. I mean, look at this country. This was the first country that truly gave religious freedom. And because of that great religious freedom that we had in this country, the church was allowed and really thrived and prospered in the late 1800s into the 1900s. But we must keep in mind that there are other forms of government that people can also that will also provide for the gospel. The Roman government, that's when the gospel was first preached under Roman rule. It was certainly not a democracy, not even close. Yet it provided an environment for which the gospel could thrive. So we just need to keep that in mind. It's whatever system of government happens to be in place, we must submit to it. If Christians are to be the light of the world, then we must set the best example we can in our daily life in submission to God's will, which includes submission to the civil authorities. Now, with this in mind, how do we go about setting this positive example in our dealings with civil rule? We have already discussed the need to submit to civil government. In submission, therefore, we must obey the law and pay what is due the civil government. Romans 13, verse 7. He says, render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. So with regard to obedience to civil law, Peter said for Christians to submit yourselves to every ordinance of God for the Lord's sake. Now by the phrase every ordinance, Peter means for the Christian to be in complete and willful compliance to every law and regulation imposed by the civil government, including those that we do not personally agree with or deem necessary. Of all people, Christians should be the most conscientious in obeying every civil law. We need to set a good example to those in the world by obeying all traffic laws, for instance. If we run four stoplights and make an illegal lane change into the church parking lot, what kind of example have we set for the world? If we cut somebody off and, or just act rudely or just drive past them at 90 miles an hour and then turn into the church building, we just set a terrible example that we're people that we don't really believe in authority. That's the example that we're setting. There's also another overlooked area where we can set an example and is in respect to copyright laws. Many people have, at various times, people have come to me and said, "Oh, I've got this great music CD. You ought to hear it. In fact, I'll just make you a copy, and then you can have it." Or somebody said, "Oh, I got this cool computer game, and let me make you a copy, and you can have it and take home." And to these offers, I always say no because it would be illegal. And they look at me like, "Huh? How is that illegal?" It's only illegal if I make copies to sell. I said, well, people that believe that, they need to look, they need to read the fine print on their CD cases and on their computer software licensing agreements. If in anything in this world we are unsure of whether it is legal or not, we must err on the side of caution. Peter commanded that Christians obey every law or ordinance of man. Romans 13, verse 7, Paul commanded that we pay the civil government its due. The first two things he mentioned here were tribute and custom. Tribute, of course, refers to taxation, and custom refers to the import and export taxes and tariffs imposed upon trade. Now, both are necessary in order for the government to meet the cost of fulfilling its responsibility towards its citizens to be a minister of God to thee for good. Now, Paul later said, for this cause ye tribute also, ye pay tribute also, for they are God's ministers attending continually upon this very thing. So with this verse, Paul gives the reason why the civil government is allowed to impose taxes upon the people and why the people must pay them. Now, many Christians are opposed to the idea of paying taxes on the ground that the government often misuses our tax money. They use it to fund programs such as Planned Parenthood, which encourages abortion, and for other things that are unrighteous. I'm sure that Jesus was also opposed to some of what the Roman Empire was doing with its tribute money. In Matthew chapter 22, verses 17 through 22, some men came to Jesus and tried to ensnare him and ask, is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? Now, after noting the image and superscription of Caesar upon a coin, Jesus then replied to them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God. See, Jesus recognized that the coin bore the image of Caesar and belonged to him. After all, he had commissioned the coin's creation. And since the coin was his, since it bore his image and was created by his authority, Caesar could impose whatever taxation he deemed necessary. Similarly, mankind bears the image of God, his creator. He must therefore render himself to God. In rendering self to God, man must submit to civil government and pay what is his due. If we submit to civil government, or we submit to God's will and pay taxes, we can have a clean conscience because we have obeyed the clear command of Christ himself. We as tax-paying citizens are not directly responsible for how the government uses the money. But fortunately, in this country, we do have a voice. We can vote against those who would misuse our tax money, and we are obligated to do so, I believe. Ultimately, the civil government bears the responsibility for using its funds for the good of the people, and those who misuse it fall under the condemnation of God. So in conclusion this afternoon, the Christian needs to understand that the civil government is approved and even ordained of God. If we ignore this clear New Testament teaching, we will invoke the wrath of God. Also, we need to understand the duties for which civil government has been appointed to fulfill and lend our prayers on behalf of the government so that it might provide an environment which the gospel can prosper. Finally, we must seek to